Hey, Steve, what do you eat for breakfast?
Mostly sawdust, Colin.
Well, let me tell you, sawdust, while tasty, is not healthy.
You're kidding me.
I'm serious. In fact, why don't I encourage you to check out NatureBox.com, because NatureBox.com has spice, raisin, pumpkin seed oatmeal, blueberry, apple, sunflower seed oatmeal. Do you like oatmeal?
I do.
What if you didn't? They also have granola. We're talking chocolate, hazelnut granola, hazelnut and chocolate in granola. Ooh, sinful. Banana bread granola, chocolate chia granola, and even PB&J granola. Off of your sandwich, in the granola, right in the bowl. Get out the spoon. I'm having peanut butter and jelly. Ain't nobody can tell me what to do. And here's the best part, Steve. You can sign up to NatureBox.com for a free trial. Five snacks. Count them. One snack. Two snack. Let's just jump ahead to five snacks sent to you in the mail. And it's free. Free snacks. Well, what if you're a little doubtful? Are you a little doubtful, Steve?
I can be. I mean, I have a long, long history with sawdust.
Okay. Well, let me help your skepticism by telling you NatureBox guarantees your snatisfaction. That's right. They had to make up a word just for their product. But here's the best part. Free snacks. You'll also be eating healthier. You'll be eating smarter through snacks. That's NatureBox.com. Sign up and get five free snacks delivered right to your door. Cherry vanilla granola. This week on the Pressure Cast, pro gamers get drug tested, Rise of the Tomb Raider comes to the PlayStation 4, and a new Nintendo president is rumored. Plus, impressions of Hadafu Boyfriend and Tembo, the badass elephant. Everything happening in the world of video games is here, now, on the Pressure Cast. Live from the 52nd floor of VideoGamesAreDumb.com Industries, it's the 88th episode of the Pressure Cast, VideoGamesAreDumb.com's weekly podcast that posts every single Monday on iTunes, Stitcher, YouTube, TuneIn Radio, and America's longest running independent newspaper at ShepherdExpress.com. My name is Colin Tanner.
Sure, it's not Borat?
Borat. My wife. And across from me, the most handsome man in video games.
Oh.
Steve Cuff.
Oh, man.
I know. Live up to it. If you could see him, audience.
It's beautiful. You've never seen a sexier hungover man in your life.
slightly hungover.
A little bit.
We have so much news to get to, Steve. We can't possibly just shoot the breeze. What'd you drink last night?
What didn't I drink last night?
Oh, there we go.
I don't know. I was at the Brady Street Festival, so I had a big plastic bucket full of vodka and some other stuff.
Okay.
Had a couple of Moscow mules, a couple of whiskey diets. It gets kind of blurry from there.
See, in case you're not familiar with this area of Milwaukee, the Brady Festival is when everyone dresses up like characters from the Brady Bunch and the Brady Bunch movie, which if you've never seen the Brady Bunch movie, they did add a character, which was, of course, her former husband that was thought to be dead in Hawaii. Long story there. And Milwaukee, we just get shit-faced. Mm-hmm. And then we all get in the squares. We have the squares set up, the 9x9 grid, and we have to climb in there.
I've always been a Peter Brady, but Colin is definitely a Marsha.
Oh, I can't help it. I get so flustered sometimes. I mean, I just want everyone to look at me. That's all I want. Oh, excellent, Steve. Excellent. Let's get on. I was thinking about this the other week. If you've never listened to the show and it just starts off like this, you're probably like, well, fuck this. Click, you know, if you have a dial on your computer or something, click, I don't know, or on your phone. If you have a dial on your phone, email us about that. This is the show where every single week we break down everything happening in the world of video games in 7 segments or less. We cover financial news, all the releases of the week. Not all the releases. What am I talking about?
Just the ones that matter.
Just go to my YouTube. You want to see all the releases? Go watch that. All right. I'm not going to be covering mobile games. I'm not some goddamn animal. But we got emails. We got financial news. We got the hype train. We got so many different segments. We talk about the history of video games. We cram it down in less than 2 hours and put it right in your ears. Right in there. But we always start off the show, until this becomes a regular thing, I'm not confident it will be, with emails. That's right. You can write into the show, pressurecast@gmail.com or 954-947-7377 or 954-97-PRESS. I don't know. Are these numbers consistent?
I think so. That sounds about right.
Look, if you want the number, it's there. It's there in the description of the podcast below. If you're watching this on YouTube, it's in the description. You can call us, leave a voicemail, send a text message, or email pressurecast@gmail.com to have your voice be heard instead of my voice. Well, it'll be my voice reading your voice, which would be like, you know, is that when you're like being possessed by a ghost, you know? You ever watch those episodes of Dateline where they try and explain the occult? I love those.
Oh, God.
Where it's like, she awoke in a haze, not sure what would happen. I moved my car keys when I was asleep, you know? Like, it's that type of shit. Starting it off, we have an email from Tom, a.k.a. at Sergeant_Mofo on Twitter. Longtime friend of the Pressure Cast. Real longtime friend of the Pressure Cast. Here's what he had to say. Hey, Colin and Steve.
Ooh.
I didn't forget you.
My first shout out.
Before I get into my question about Shenmue 3. Okay. I'll bury the lead here. What the heck is your Twitter handle these days? Update those handles on your website. I've told you I don't recommend the website right now. I've got to do a whole different thing.
Videogamesaredumb.com. Don't go there.
Don't go there. Not worth it. The Twitter handle for the Pressure Cast is @PressureCastPod. My personal Twitter handle is the same as always, @DrCryChop. That's @DrCryChop. Steve, just say yours.
Yeah, I'm @SteveCuff.
Just say it.
C-U-F-F.
See you, friendly face. All right. Anyways, Shenmue 3, it's happening.gif. It's Kickstarter's most successful video game, and I can't wait to see how it pans out. Looking at the numbers, there were over 69,320 backers who combined to contribute $6,333,295. That breaks down to an average of $91.36 per person. Wow, we're going to start calling you Calculator Mofo.
It's our stats guy.
Now let's assume. Ooh, wow. Now let's assume each backer is a copy sold at $60. Revenue generated would be around $4,159,200. Considering you was hoping for a $10 million budget, standard retail release would not be profitable for any publishers. Considering the tale of Ryu will require additional entries to see the story's completion, I don't see a scenario where Shenmue 4 and beyond will see the light of day unless they are funded through Kickstarter. I also worry if Shenmue 3 doesn't meet expectations, the numbers of backers next go round will be significantly less than 69,320. Do you envision a scenario where Shenmue 4 goes back to traditional retail model? If not, do you think there will be enough support to crowdfund Shenmue 4 when it is time, or will Shenmue 3 be the last entry in the series? Also, I don't have any erotic fan fiction in my back pocket at the moment, but I will say the cast of Streets of Rage seems rife with erotic fan fiction opportunity. Hands of Power, Bare Knuckle, and let's not forget Dr. Zan. If there's one thing Far Cry Blood Dragon showed us, it's that cyborgs can be sexy. Anyways, wish you guys nothing but the best. Here's to your continued growth and success. Cheers. Tom, a.k.a. Sergeant Mofo. Oh my God, Shenmue 3, we're still talking about it. Well, I can't blame him because it's like, it's all I talked about before it, so I guess it's all I'm talking about after it. Let's talk about this real quick. Shenmue 1 and 2, that covers, I believe, 6 chapters altogether, maybe more, because the first one is chapter 1, and then I believe it covers like 5 chapters in the next game, because that's when he goes to, I'm not even going to say what happens, because I want to spoil it. If I were you, Suzuki, I wouldn't plan on Shenmue 4. I'd get that shit done, son.
Yeah, well, he doesn't exactly have the best track record for getting Shenmue games out, so...
No.
You know, this could be the last one based on just historical precedence. The other thing is, it's impossible to say how well something like this is going to do. I mean, it could drum up a lot of interest. It could, you know, it could introduce Shenmue to a whole new generation of players.
Yeah.
Who might love it, or it could just, you know, make people like Colin happy and me happy, and then just kind of go away after that. Because yeah, there's 69,000 backers, but for big retail AAA releases, they
you
want
need
like
a,
yeah, like
70,000.
At least 70,000. Yeah. No, I mean you need millions and millions of sales. You don't need thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands.
Oh, of course, thousands of sales actually does work out if you budget within that. But
I don't think Shenmue. No, Shenmue's not a game that is really good with budgets.
It's not some guy working over the course of 10 years after work on like a Metroidvania style game. This is a big time title, and you know, I agree. I don't see a scenario where Shenmue 4 goes to traditional retail, but I don't see it going to Kickstarter either because. Once you've already done it, and then you're like, we're back. Let's get another one of these babies going. Mm-hmm. You're like, well, no. I mean, this has been the long, drawn-out narrative of, please, no. Please, no. Please, okay. And it's like, whoa, he said okay! You know, and then the next time that happens, he's said okay again, but I don't know.
Yeah, I think the most likely scenario for Shenmue 4 would be it does reasonably well, and Sony goes, okay, we'll bankroll the next one, and it'll be a digital-only release, and we'll have exclusive rights.
Shenmue 3 will not be a success. I love Shenmue. I love Shenmue. Here's my problem right here. Shenmue 1 and 2. If you get a chance to play those, you might be into Shenmue 3. What are your options to play those titles right now?
Oh, Lord.
I can get a Dreamcast. And then I could play part two on the Xbox. What if you're in the UK? Oh, I get the English voice cast to part one and then not the English cast to part two. Oh, okay. What about if I use emulation? Oh, crud. I got to use the Dreamcast emulation for both titles. And oh, I guess I can use the English cast because someone poured that over, but it's literally at 60 kilobytes a second. Like, seriously, you're... involvement with part three is going to be solely based off your experience of part one and part two. Otherwise, you're going to be like, I don't see what the big deal is. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm sorry, but part two ends on a huge cliffhanger. And if it starts with a huge cliffhanger, I'm sorry, you don't have the context for it. It'll just be like, well, whatever. I don't know. It's Citizen Kane. If it's like, welcome to Citizen Kane. It's a story about a sled. Well, the sled must be pretty cool, huh? Well, he just talks about his life. What's the big deal about the sled? You know?
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I don't really see it doing a ton of business unless Sega decides to give us like Shenmue HD collection before Shenmue 3 comes out, and then that drums up enough interest. That's the only thing I can think of.
Rumors are that was actually finished about 4 years ago and never released.
Oh, well, good. If they're just sitting on it, then they might as well put it out. Assholes.
They do have that new president, or not a new president, but someone in charge over at Sega. You know, they just came into a position of power and they're just like, hey, sure, Phantasy Star Online, let's just release that. Who gives a shit? So I wouldn't be surprised if we do see Shenmue HD. But if we don't, I'm sorry. No. Like, there's no chance of a Shenmue 4. And Yu Suzuki shouldn't bank on it. He should wrap up the whole story. Because I think I would actually find it to be cruel not to wrap up the whole story. Even if he doesn't have the financial possibility for something like that. It would be irksome, really, because it's like, oh, okay, hey, you've been waiting 15 years. I think I'll tell, I don't know, like 4 chapters, but you know, here's another cliffhanger and it'll never happen. Yeah. Like, this is, you know, I don't know. You've got to do it now. So Tom, thank you for the email. Thank you very much for the email, Tom.
We love you, Tom.
Thank you. At Sergeant, or at SGT underscore mofo on Twitter. Thank you, Tom. Thank you. Thank you. Moving on over to the Gooseman. Goose.
Gooseman.
Yes. He wrote in last week, and he has some good news for us. In fact, he starts it off. He's calling an additional person if available. Good news! Exclamation point. This is a note from the official Colin Tanner fan club.
Ooh.
I know this is a big deal for me. We put it to a vote, and I have been elected president of the Colin Tanner Fan Club. Polite applause.
Okay. There you go. There you go. Golf clap action there for you.
Wimbledon. And as such, we have put forward a list of issues that are most pressing for the Pressure Cast moving forward. First order of business is the creepy money voice. As it turns out, nobody on the internet likes the creepy money voice. It's not my call. I like the money voice. Still, I have been elected the messenger to let you know what the majority of the internet wants, and they don't want the creepy money voice. You don't want to disappoint all the fans in the club, right?
Yeah, it's true.
Second order of business. We want a soda machine in the break room. Don't pre-order us that Juggernog mini fridge or anything that small. We want a full soda dispensing machine and put the soda at 50 cents per can. Fanta and Mr. Pibb ranked high on what your fans want in stock. I just want Lipton Brisk. That's Brisk, baby. Third order of business. Your sponsors, the good folks at Box Snacks or Dial of Diabetes or Fantasy Sports Gamblers or whoever, don't appreciate you asking those too young to know what a phone is to click on your bone-shaped icon down below your video. Please file this with the creepy money voice as the first order of business. We are all for this. We are all in this for the money, and we want higher pressure cast profit margins. We're not going to get there making parents uncomfortable with the show. In summary, creepy money voice out, choo-choo train noises in, Wii U out, Ash versus Evil Dead in, telling viewers about your bone shapes out, money in. This concludes the first meeting of the Colin Tanner Fan Club. Until next time, keep up the good work on the show. Goose. P.S. Your fans don't write emails to the show because you don't thank them for writing in at the end of the show. Me, I don't care either way. Well, thank you, Goose.
That was nice, Goose. Thank you. I like that. I like that. We're taking steps towards fan fiction with this.
Thank you, Goose.
I think if it was a little bit sexier, we need some sexy fan fiction.
Thank you, Goose. Thank you, Goose. That's a good idea, Steve. Thank you, Steve. Thank you for that. Thank you. As for the money voice, we got rid of it last week, so I don't know. That's already gone. As for the mini fridge, I have contracted a place that I'm renting out currently in the middle of Alaska. It is a 12 by 12 sanctuary is the term they refer to, and I have put soda in there.
Here's what I'm thinking. Here's my challenge.
It is littered about. There's no machine yet. You just go in there and grab a soda.
There's just soda on the floor.
Yeah.
Here's my challenge to the Pressure Cast listeners. When you're penning your sexy fan fiction, here's the theme for this week. There's a PlayStation 1 game called Irritating Stick. So the theme this week is Pressure Cast Cross Irritating Stick. Sexy edition.
Sure. Great.
How many emails are we going to get that are just, and then Colin put his penis between the electrified fence and lost the game, because that's basically all irritating.
That game is really good.
It's really good.
There's kind of a pseudo ripoff. I think that was on like XBLA last generation. That was pretty good. Last email. Oh, wait. Thank you, Goose.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Goose. Thank you. Last email comes from Eros2K. Hey, Colin and Steve. I found your YouTube channel a few months ago. Through your first hour of Cabela's African Adventure, and have since been lurking about enjoying your varied content. Caught the most recent Pressure Cast here today. I quite enjoyed it. The two of you have impeccable recall, all the references to old obscure games without missing a beat. I'm super impressed. Also, thank you for holding Randy Pitchford accountable for his career-long shitbaggery. Idiot of the week indeed. Keep up the great work. Cheers, Eros2K.
That was nice.
There's no question or anything in there. It's just like, oh, all right.
Good to know that people don't just think that we're shitheads. Like, that's...
Yeah, you know. Randy Pitchford does.
Oh, Randy Pitchford does. I will fight him. I'll still fight him. Get me in a boxing ring. Charity boxing match.
And my favorite thing about this week is that we are experiencing the peak of our email section. Because you know what? I guarantee you, next week, no emails. No one writes into the show.
You're going to get so much sexy fan fiction.
No, I don't believe you. Because no one writes into the show. This is a fluke. We got 3 emails in a week. That is what I call a fluke. The ratings go up. The emails go down. I can't explain it. But if you want to prove me wrong, write in pressurecast@gmail.com or call or text the pressure line. 954-947-7377. That's 954-94-PRESS. Oh, God. They're coming right for us. Get to the shelter.
No!
It's the earth-shattering stories of the week, 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 week. Oh, my goodness. 3 earth-shattering stories this week. We're going to be starting it off with Nintendo because, let's face it, that's the biggest news story of the year. Oh, boy. So, obviously, Iwata is no longer president for a variety of reasons. There's rumors going about who's going to be taking over as president. And for whatever reason, people say it might be Miyamoto.
No.
Never.
Never in a million years.
Not, no. You stop that rumor right now. That not makes sense.
But he's the best Nintendoer at Nintendo.
We were talking before the show, and I made this analogy of like when Stan Lee took over as president of Marvel. And even Stan Lee's like, wow, president of Marvel. I thought it would be spectacular. And then, you know, it turns out, no, it was bad.
Yeah.
It was bad.
Why would you put your best creative mind in like a corporate suit position? Don't you want Miyamoto making games?
That's what I'm saying. Well, he wants to retire anyway.
Yeah.
Plays banjo. Finally get rid of that banjo. Well, here's the rumor is that Jinyo Takeda, Takeda is a delicious beer though,
mm-hmm.
Takeda would be taking over as the president. There's actually a number of analysts that have spoken out about this, including Nick Parker of Parker Consulting. Wonder where he got that job. I'm pretty sure the candidate will come from within the business. The very essence of Nintendo games draws from decades of management recognizing a market desire for mass market fun. The obvious two choices are Takeda-san and Miyamoto-san. The former hardware technology company veteran, the latter the king of Nintendo's first-party content. Although it would be a romantic dream to have the company led by the father of Mario, I think Takeda-san... Did I say it right? Takeda-san has more corporate experience and really understands hardware. It was he who argued for a new interface for the Wii rather than just faster GameCube with better graphics. Not bad.
Mm-hmm.
Mike Schrim had this to say. Jinyo Takeda has a similar trajectory in the company as Iwata, and is likely a lead candidate for the job. Nintendo also has a number of executives on its board of directors who could also step up into the spot. It's very unlikely that the company would hire someone from outside Japan or from another corporation, as Nintendo doesn't need to and shouldn't want to make waves with this appointment. Most likely, it'll be a senior Japanese executive at the company, ideally someone who had a hand in game development at some point. And Takeda definitely has had his hand in game development. He's only directed three titles, the first being Punch-Out on the NES. So
that's pretty big time.
All right, let's just play Stairway to Heaven. See you later. You don't need to do nothing more,
yeah,
man.
That's all you need to do.
You are perfect. And the other two titles were Star Tropics. And then he did Zelda's Revenge Star Tropics 2.
Let's just pretend that didn't happen.
That did not happen. If you're going to play Star Tropics, by the way, there is a puzzle that requires you to use something from the instruction manual. You had to cover it in water, and there was a secret message on there. So make sure to look that up if you're going to play that on an emulator. Or
and that's why I never beat that game, because I got it from Blockbuster Video.
What a difference. So, yes, he's definitely been involved in a number of titles. He supervised Punch-Out on the Wii when they were developing that. Mm-hmm. He worked on Dr. Mario 64 as a producer. He worked on Popeye the arcade game as a producer. So he's been with the company a very long time. He does have certainly more hardware and business experience than Miyamoto. Mm-hmm. And let's just really stress this. Miyamoto, as smart of a guy as he is from when it comes to game design, is not a businessman and
no.
should not run a large corporation.
Well, and this and Takeda, he seems to have a very rare combination of talents where he understands the business end of things, but he's also had hands-on experience in hardware and in software. He obviously gets the culture of Nintendo, so it makes perfect sense that he would step in.
Forget about hardware. Forget about software. It's about cold, hard cash. Can he deliver? That's all that matters. Moving on to the next earth-shattering Nope. Doing the Pee Wee Herman again.
Yeah, you're doing the Herman.
The Paul Rubens. Earth-shattering story of the week. Not as good, but better.
Yeah, better.
Rise of the Tomb Raider. Xbox exclusive question mark? No explanation point.
To the surprise of no one.
Well, we already knew it was a timed exclusive, but here's the dealio, according to Square Enix. The Windows version will arrive on Windows 10 exclusively early 2016. Okay.
When you say Windows 10 exclusively, does that mean if I have Windows 7, I can't run?
No game.
Really?
Take a game away. Well, I don't know. I don't know. Let's just say yes. Let's just assume. Because you know what they say when you assume? You're probably right. The PlayStation 4, on the other hand, will not receive Rise of the Tomb Raider until holiday 2016, meaning a full year of exclusivity for the Xbox One. Why am I doing these accents? What's wrong?
I don't know.
What's going on today? I feel bad. There's something wrong. Of course, it launches on the Xbox One and Xbox 360 on November 15, 2015. To date, the last Tomb Raider sold 8.5 million units. A full year. That's actually rather significant.
Yeah, that's quite a bit of time. And it also makes me wonder if this is really a good idea. Like, I hope they signed a really great exclusivity deal, because this is not going to help sales for Tomb Raider.
At all. No. No, but it will help sales of Xbox, hypothetically. I do think it's an interesting move to announce that it won't come to PlayStation 4 for a full year. I wonder if that might help sales. Because people say, whatever, it'll come out in January. You know, like, people always are optimistic, you know? If they're just like, nope, that's a full year.
Yeah.
Then people might go, oh, man, well, I already want to play Halo. You're giving people more reasons to pick up the excellent Xbox One. I like that system.
I'm in a different camp. I would probably just sit on it. Like, if I was a Tomb Raider reboot super fan, which I'm kind of like, it's all right.
I liked it
just fine. It was not fun. Enough rating of Tombs, but, you know, splitting hairs here. I would probably sit on it, especially if I didn't own an Xbox One.
Hey, sit on it.
Just because, I mean, how do we not know that, you know, the edition that the PS4 gets or whatever, wouldn't it be safe to assume that it might be like a Game of the Year edition with the DLC packed in or something like that? Or a definitive edition or a whatever edition?
Well, given the history with the last Tomb Raider, I don't know if it'd be worth your while. Just because, to be honest, you know, like when they did the definitive edition, yeah, it had better graphics, but I played on PC and I looked at all the extra options. It's like, ooh, multiplayer. Get all that multiplayer DLC. It's like, I don't really know. Maybe you're right. Maybe they'll have some story pack DLC that explores the history of Laura's rope. The rope gets us backstory.
And do you think,
heck's this rope? Can I take this rope? Sure can. You know,
I mean, Tomb Raider is obviously a really popular IP, but is it enough to really sell someone? Like, if you haven't invested in a next gen console, is the sequel to the Tomb Raider reboot, is that what's going to make you pull the trigger?
Absolutely not. Okay. But it adds to the arsenal.
It does.
The arsenal of the library where you go, oh man, I really want to check out Tomb Raider, but I can't justify an Xbox, but it puts the thing in your head. Just like when somebody says, you know, my tongue won't fit in my mouth correctly. And you start going, my tongue doesn't fit in my mouth correctly either. I got you all.
Plant the seed,
you know, and then so you're like, well, yeah, but Gears looks okay. I mean, I liked Gears. Oh, Halo's pretty. I didn't get a chance to play Sunset Overdrive. I heard good things about Forza Horizon 2. You know, and before you know it, you're at GameStop in just like the zombie-like, you know, phase, and just like plunking down $350 like a tool. Tool Raider. But honestly, I think it's an excellent move from Microsoft's standpoint. You have to lock down exclusives, something that Sony unfortunately really hasn't been able to do. I mean, they got Bloodborne. Okay. Well, what else you got, Sony? Oh, you got Until Dawn, but that's first party. So, you know. What else you got? What's going on this fall? What you got?
What about the shitty race car game that doesn't work?
Vroom, vroom, Drive Club. Oh, I love my Drive Club video, because I always just get comments about, you're not turning correctly on the radius. It's like, your game sucks. The game sucks.
Why didn't you invest in a steering wheel controller and pedals?
Actually, I was talking to somebody about that. I really do want to get one of those. Mm-hmm. But I have to become a multimillionaire and also buy 3 monitors. If I had $1 million, I would have a driving room. I'd have a flying room. I'm telling you, like, I would be like the kid from
your official Euro Truck Simulator room.
I would be like the kid from Blank Check. Let me tell you, I would be having some good times eating a giant thing of ice cream in the back of a limousine and awkwardly sort of dating like a 28-year-old woman.
Mm-hmm.
That's weird. That's a weird movie. But yeah, you know, Blank Check, I think it's out on DVD, so definitely check that out. I'm sorry. Tomb Raider coming out November 15th. Check that out. And then wait a year if you have the PlayStation 4, or like 6 months if you have a PC, Windows 10. Be there. Drugs. I love them. You love them.
They're the best.
What goes better with drugs than playing them damn video games?
That's what they're made for, right?
Sound like some creepy uncle. Yeah, come on, you want to play video games? Let's get some drugs in you.
Let me tell you, most terrifying experience of my life was the first time I played Resident Evil 4 because I was on acid.
There you go. That's not true, is it?
That is absolutely true.
Get the fuck out.
Yeah, well.
No, we stopped the show. Let's hear about that.
It was kind of an interesting story. I took acid, and then I felt kind of weird, so I was like, I'm going to go lay down.
Interesting story.
And I was laying in bed, and all of a sudden, I just like woke up, and I popped out of bed because I thought my lamp was the football coach, the head football coach of the Detroit Lions, and
sure.
My lamp slash football coach was yelling at me, and he said it was my fault that the Detroit Lions were so bad, and I was really upset.
To be fair, there's a reason they call that guy Old Lampy.
Yeah.
So
my roommate comes in, he's like, oh, I heard you yelling at your lamp, like, why don't you chill out? I just bought this new game, let's play it. I'm like, cool, what'd you buy? He's like, Resident Evil 4. And like, I wasn't like registering that this was a bad idea.
Right.
And then I just sat there like in the fetal position for like 6 hours and watched him play like terrified.
Well, was this on the PS2 or GameCube?
It was GameCube.
God, you were in college then?
What was it, like 2000? No, it must have been the PS2 version then.
Because it came out
later.
Yeah, a little bit later.
Okay, yeah. So that was the first time I played it.
I like how you're telling me about acid and lamps yelling at you. So I'm like, whoa. What year was the GameCube? Was it for the PS2?
Yeah,
because that was one of the Capcom 5.
Because was it 2005 or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, that was it.
Yeah. That's amazing. That is the story of the
story of the week.
The drug-related video game story.
Do drugs
of the week.
Play video games? That's the official Pressure Cast branding.
You know what? There are a few drugs as wonderful as Adderall. Yes, the magic pill that has literally no repercussions. It's weird.
Yeah, it just makes you think you're smarter than you are and smoke a whole pack of cigarettes in like 2 hours.
Yeah, that's it. But the Electronic Sports League says, nay, no more drugs for you, competitive pro gamers.
Boo.
Yes, this is after last week, Corey Semphis Frisson, whatever. Corey, the Counter-Strike Global Offense player, he admitted that his team, Cloud9, used Adderall during one of the Electronic Sports League's tournaments. Oops, probably... Mm. Probably shouldn't have done that. So they have announced that starting in August, they will have the ESL 1 Cologne. One is like a separate division from ESL. The Cologne in Germany, they are going to be doing drug testing. This is also going to be taking place at every event following that, including the IEM, ESL 1, ESL, ESEA Pro Leagues, and many more. Here's what's up. Wow, this is crazy. They are teaming up with the National Anti-Doping Agentur. Yes, Agentur, because that's in Germany. The NADA, N-A-D-A, NADA. How many drugs you want? NADA, if you want to be a pro gamer. Here's what they said. Research and determine an anti-performance enhancing drugs policy that is fair, feasible, and respects the privacy of the players while simultaneously providing conclusive testing results, man, because we're just all here to have a good time. I have to wonder if they're going to just be okay with people smoking weed, because that's what it sounds like when they said privacy, you know?
Yeah, I'm sure they're only going to look at, like, amphetamines and, like, when they talk about
uppers.
Performance enhancing, things like that.
I mean,
game blood doping.
I mean, I'm just saying, like, you know, things like, you know, I mean, Coke is right out because that's good. I mean, I don't know if Coke helps you play video games. They really should have had a scene in like Scarface where he's like playing Duck Hunt or Lethal Enforcers 1. But of course, the movie came out before then. So whatever. I mean, I'm all for this because they're also going to be teaming up with the ESL. ESL will also be teaming up with the World Anti-Doping Agency to take care of all the other regions, including Australia, Asia, and USA. Because let's just face it, I feel like a lot of these, oh my God, I wonder if Evo is going to be picking up on that because Evo just ended.
Or the international or like the really big money tournaments. This has a lot of problems for a lot of reasons. First and foremost, I guess I read that they were going to do like skin and like hair testing.
Oh God.
Which is not the best way to drug test.
No.
It's prone to false positives. So blood testing or urine testing would probably be better, but that's a lot more expensive. Drug testing is very expensive. Every time you piss in a cup and someone has to check it for drugs, it costs like $100, $200.
Whoa.
So that's a lot of money.
That you could spend that money on drugs.
Yeah, you could have been spending that money on drugs. So that's kind of a problem. The other problem is Adderall is a prescription drug.
Exactly.
So, and these tournaments are primarily populated by young white males who happen to be like the core demographic for legally prescribed Adderall.
My son says he wants to be an artist and a pro gamer. Can you give him some drugs?
Mm-hmm.
So I don't like this.
There's going to be a lot of people who are playing these games that are legitimately prescribed Adderall. And then there's going to be a lot of other people who can go to a, you know, kind of a crooked doctor and just get a script for Adderall. No problem.
Yeah.
No problem.
Where are those doctors?
Well, honestly, if you're like a shaggy-haired 16-year-old shithead and you just go into a doctor's office with your mom and say the right things, you can probably get Adderall.
Let's say you're older. Where would you, like, in a hypothetical situation here?
Yeah, I got a guy. Yeah,
okay, because it's I don't know. Like sometimes we'll be watching TV and looking at my phone, and I can't follow the plot.
I need the drugs. So yeah, there's going to be some iffy and expensive things when it comes to actually doing the drug testing itself. And you also have all these gray areas where a lot of the things they're going to be looking for can be easily prescribed or masked. So
here's the thing. If you do take Adderall regularly or any prescription drug, the amount that's in your bloodstream, I don't think it actually builds up. It lessens, if I'm not mistaken. Mm-hmm. Your body gets more adapted to it, so it processes that quicker. So I think they will be able to figure out, like, but even then you could just take smaller doses, but then you wouldn't have the same effect. I don't know.
Well, and the other thing that people aren't really talking about here is they're talking about these big major tournaments and stuff, but a lot of the qualifiers for these things, like for Counter-Strike and stuff, they do the qualifiers online.
Yeah.
So are you going to fly to every corner of the earth to have a bunch of random kids in their mom's basement pissing to cups? Probably not. Mm. So you can just get loaded during the qualifiers and do really well, maybe. Also, I think, how about mandatory drugs for competitive video game
players? Yeah, that's what I'm saying. This is the part where we should just abandon all, like,
eat a bag of mushrooms and play Dance Dance Revolution. That's what you need to do.
Yeah, he's just out on the sidewalk, just, like, kicking his feet up in the air. they did outline a little bit about marijuana. They said that you can't smoke nugs. You can smoke middies, but not if it's really good middies. So that's, unfortunately, that's...
Things will be measured on the dank scale.
Yeah, you know, where it's like, well, I guess if it's like decent swag to average middies, then you're in the clear. So there you go. That's it for the Earth Shutter... Earth-shattering stories of the week. Great. I'm glad we did that. But now it's time to get out of here. We are going on a trip.
Where are we going, Colin?
We are all aboard on a sentence that's going nowhere towards the hype train. Toot, toot. Powered by video game buzz, so feel the vibrations of marketing as feel the marketing vibrations as we barrel towards Video Game Satisfaction Station with the Hype Train. This is where we cover upcoming game releases and recent developments to get you all psyched up for the world of video games. Toot toot! Starting off with Nintendo. They actually apparently patented a sleep monitoring device with this is very, very strange. This is going to be a weird story. Follow me here. Mm-hmm. NeoGAF leaked some documents of this patent. It was basically, it looks like an iPhone charging dock. And according to the patent, the system is going to be reading the user as it sleeps without having anything connected to it physically. According to the patent, this information processing system comprises a portable terminal. The portable terminal detects sensor information for assessing a user's emotions. It would be permissible, as an example, for the sensor information to be sound information, which is detected by a microphone, or image information, which is captured by a camera. The information processing system assesses the user's emotions on the basis of the sensor information. The portable terminal detects the sensor information in a period which the said portable terminal is in a standby state.
That sounds creepy and weird.
It does. But if you say that about anything in Nintendo, it's like, well, you take the 3DS and it takes your face and your friends' faces and they're flying around the room and you gotta murder them, you know, like anything Nintendo does.
It seems like the evolution of the vitality meter.
Oh, the vitality sensor, the clip-on finger thing. Which...
Yeah, so it's like, what if you had that, but it watched you while you sleep and then it told you how you were feeling?
How do you feel? Tell the screen. The patent was actually filed late last year, around the time that Iwata and Miyamoto were all doing that press conference where they were apologizing and taking 50% pay cuts. I believe that was last year, I want to say like March?
So, February. Breaking news, the NX is a creepy alarm clock.
Toot toot! Retailers have revealed a little bit more information about Mighty No. 9, which of course Mighty No. 9 is going to be arriving in September this fall.
Wait a minute here. Hold on, I have an update to this news.
Amazon, GameStop, and Walmart say 2016. Uh-oh. 2016. It looks like Mighty No. 9 might be delayed. No word on from Deep Silver. They didn't comment on this news. So is that the physical copies? Is it the digital copies?
I think, and this is just conjecture.
Therefore,
here,
you are.
Therefore,
sir.
I am. I think it just might be the physical copy.
Mm-hmm.
Sort of like how with Shovel Knight, how the physical copy didn't come out until far after the digital release.
Right.
The only reason I say that is because I want to say like 2 weeks ago, I got an email from the Mighty No. 9 Kickstarter thing, and they were like, hey, we're almost ready to go. Tell us what system you want it on. And I had to fill out the little survey thing.
Because the systems you could choose from were Xbox One, PlayStation 4, Wii U, PC, 3DS, and Vita.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, the 3DS and Vita versions will not be released until later.
Yeah, and I chose the PlayStation one because it's got crossplay. So I was going to play it on the Wii U, but then I was like, no, I want crossplay.
When you getting that PlayStation 4, son? What
Eventually,
you doing?
One of these days. One of these days.
All right. Because then we can play some Rocket League online.
I know.
Jesus Christ.
I have had so many friends, like people I haven't talked to from back in Detroit. I haven't talked to them in years. Friends that I still keep up with. Like, I have random people just like, dude, why aren't you playing Rocket League? Let's play Rocket League. I want to play Rocket League with you.
They're like, hey, how you been? Ah, my family died in a plane crash, but this Rocket
yes.
League thing's really
like,
good.
Like, literally, like, hey, old friend, let's catch up. Like, I'm just getting, Rocket League, do it now.
Dude, Rocket League is becoming a problem in my life, and I think I need to stop.
Mm-hmm. I'll get a PlayStation 4 eventually. I just gotta rob that bank. I've been working on it.
Yeah.
I got the blueprints.
It's just a dollar sign and like a domino mask. You're like, eh, okay, this is all coming together.
Yeah. I've been watching Heat a lot. Like, I'm just totally getting it. I'm growing my hair out.
Well, you won't be getting Mighty No. 9 from retailers until 2016. Toot toot! Inafune also went to Kickstarter for the that other game, Red Ash, which is sort of like a Mega Man Legends, sort of like a sequel to that. Now, that was supposed to be coming out on the PC or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just a bizarre project. They have announced that it will also come to PlayStation 4. They include the quote, however, we still need your support to make this a reality. We have now updated the console port stretch goal to reflect this new development. And, that stretch goal is going to be a bit of a problem because, well, it ends on August 3rd, and they still have over $300,000 to go.
Oh, geez.
Which, compared to Mighty No. 9, that reached $4 million, just immediately obliterated that. And I'm sure it's going to be doing just ducky now that Mighty No. 9 is missing its release date a month before it was supposed to come out.
Yeah, I don't understand why they're worrying about like toy licensing deals and movie deals and all these other things. Like, just get your game done and out, and then we can start talking about these things.
Oh, and by the way, it's not a game. I don't know if you understood that, but that let me correct you there. That $800,000 is just for, you know, like the early part. It's like a pre-log.
Well, they have like pre-alpha screens of it.
No, don't they? But it's not the game. See, the more they fund on the stretch goals, the more chapters you get. It's not even the complete game.
Jesus.
It's essential. No, yeah. So remember, you remember Metal Gear Solid Ground Zeroes? It's that.
Ugh.
It's that. Give us $800,000 for that, and if you give us a lot more money, it'll come to the PlayStation 4. Oh, and by the way, we got $90,000 for our anime series so far. Because they're all supposed to be an anime series. So you think you're getting a game. You're not getting the game. You're getting the first chapter of the game, and there are literally like six more chapters.
That is not okay.
I know.
And it looks like butts, too.
What's wrong with that?
You know, it's just, I don't know.
You gotta stop saying butts, because butts are great.
Yeah, butts are cool. It looks like bad butts. It looks like cottage cheese butts. Ugh. It looks like it could run on the PlayStation 1.
Everyone's got their preferences, Steve. Let's not call anybody out here. we have another story. Wait a minute. Hold on there. Toot toot! The Fallout Anthology Collection! Yes. Yes.
Yes.
It's shaped like a mini nuke. It holds Fallout 1, 2, and Tactics, as well as Fallout 3 Game of the Year, and Fallout New Vegas Ultimate Edition, all that DLC inside of a mini bomb. But what's this? There's an extra slot there. What do you put there? Fallout 4, my friends.
Aww.
It's coming to PC, obviously, because who wants to play Fallout 1 on their fucking PlayStation 4?
Mm-hmm.
Look at these graphics. Fallout 2 is pretty great, though.
Yeah, it's really fun. All those games are great. And, I mean, the problem is I don't know. Like, if you're a Fallout fan, if you're the type of person who would buy this, don't you already own all these things?
No.
Like, Fallout 1 and 2 and Fallout Tactics were like free on good old games for a long time.
No, you're okay. That's a good point.
And then Fallout 3 and New Vegas, like that's like the perennial Steam sale, like buy them for a dollar.
What are you trying to say here?
I'm just trying to say, if you're into physical media and you're a big fan and you want it as a collector's item, cool, but like the practicality of it just isn't there. Unlike, say, the I almost said the Skyrim collection, the Elder Scrolls collection.
Oh, that's so cool.
Where you're getting a lot of games that, I mean, it's not like I can just go anywhere and play like Daggerfall or something,
no,
right?
No, that's the thing. You can go anywhere in Skyrim. Do anything. That's
do anything.
Yeah, so they're not as available.
What percentage
convenient.
Of the show is just me misinterpreting what you're saying at this point? Where you're trying to say something intelligent, I'm like, no, I'm gonna make a joke. $50. Yes, no.
No. I don't need it. I have all this stuff, and I don't have room for a nuke in my little apartment.
October 2nd. Yes, no.
That's a day.
Okay. That is the day.
Tuesday? What is that?
That is. Let's go on to the next story. Toot, toot! Xbox One owners, mouse and keyboard support? Phil Spencer says this. Yep. Keyboard and mouse support for Xbox would need to be there for this to work. Those aren't far away. Mouse and keyboard support. So, what would this mean for Windows 10 integration on the Xbox One? Ooh, Think about that. I mean, I have a PC, you have a PC, but let's say you're some 14-year-old idiot who's just like, you know, well, 14. I mean, would mouse and keyboard be appealing to you?
No. If I wanted to play mouse and keyboard, I'd have a PC.
Yeah.
So it's just like, what if you had a really shitty PC? That's what the Xbox One is, basically.
I mean, you're not going to want to play your Calls of Duty? I mean, how much fun it would be when the next first-person shooter comes out and everybody's using their controllers and you put in the mouse and keyboard and you're just dominating,
and it's sort of
dominating.
It's counterintuitive to the idea of a home console, which is like you don't use a mouse and keyboard because you don't have like a desk set up unless your home console is at your desk?
I hate that. Yeah.
That's what you have to do because you have to make videos. But like,
I have to.
You have to.
The court said I had to do something.
It's weird. Have you ever seen the movie Speed? It's like that. If Colin doesn't make 3 videos a week, he explodes.
I really do. I have nightmares where nothing comes out, and I have to dig through my PS1 collection. I'm like, does anyone want to see another video on Incredible Crisis? I mean, you know, I agree with you to a point. I mean, like, it depends on what the support entails. I mean, if you're essentially buying a cheap PC for kids to write their, you know, if they could actually sell it on this, check it out. Check it out. Let's say Microsoft Word comes with every Xbox One, and it's like, yeah, you can file your reports right on here and do all that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And so when the kids are being, you know, challenged between PlayStation 4 and Xbox One, they're like, oh, they can do homework on this too. You know, the old computer thing they used to do with the Commodores.
It gets really weird because now you're getting into like 80s luxury family computer territory where your branding gets mixed up. So what is the Xbox One? Well, it's a video game machine and it's like a weird television DVR thing and it's also a shitty Windows 10 PC. And then on the software end of things, it's not like, unless like you set the keyboard and mouse to just emulate points on the controller, like you're going to have to integrate this into the game. So if Call of Duty doesn't have a mouse and keyboard setting, well, you're fucked, right?
Luckily, EA is there and it's always in the game.
It is.
It is. Absolutely. By the way,
Singer of the week.
No, it's you keep saying all the relevant shit and I'll just keep making bad jokes.
That's waka waka.
Honk honk. Toot toot. Gears of War. Ultimate is a word. Is coming to the PC. But according to Phil Spencer, Gears on Windows 10 is later than the Xbox One version. No release date set there, which is just awful. Of course, the Ultimate Edition is coming on the 25th and is only $40. It does include a number of enhancements brought over from Gears of War 3 into the original Gears of War there. And I already got my copy. Where's yours, everybody?
Windows 10 stuff. That's coming soon, too, right?
Like, Windows 10 I thought was out.
No, it's July 31st, I want to say.
Oh, that's
nice. That's when my pirated copy of Windows 7 told me that I can have Windows 10 for free. So
I can't update to Windows 10. I have too much hardware that is based around Windows 7 and 8 that really I cannot rely on.
Yeah,
to.
I mean, I have the ace in my back pocket is I'll just go back to Windows 7 if Windows 10 is dumb.
Yeah.
But I guess I'll do my full report next week after I install it. Here's the list of Steam games that no longer work.
Also, of course, according to Justin Engelbart, he will be on the show next week.
Oh, my
God. You listening, Justin? I don't think you're going to be here.
I don't think he is either.
He's driving for 3 fucking days through a desert, and he says he's going to be here, and he wants to be on the show.
So wait, is he leaving like on Thursday from Los Angeles and he's driving straight here?
Yes.
He's not going to do that.
And he says it's going to be better because he's going to be hella tired. I'm like,
he's going to be sleep deprived and unshowered and unkempt and he's going to be a mess.
I'm just going to keep saying Mario. Just mess with Mario. Practice right now, Justin. You're driving in the desert. I know you're listening. Toot toot, Devil's Third. It's coming to the Wii U eventually. Who knows when? And it actually will be published by Nintendo of America in America for Americans, contrary to earlier reports from Unseen 64, or rumors, I should say, from Unseen 64. But we know that it will be coming to the PC in a free-to-play capacity next month. Developer Valhalla had this to say. In consideration of cultural characteristics in each region, the content is being optimized via co-development with local publishers, service territories, and the details of the game content will be announced accordingly. This is in regards to the idea that on the PC, it will not be the full title. It will only be the multiplayer aspects and free-to-play. And
this is bad for so many reasons.
But they've said, please do not use tab PC. Make sure to use real PC, not tab PC. If you don't get that joke, listen to last week's episode. The weirdest thing. They didn't say gamepad. They said tab.
Don't use the tab. Tab soda. Drink tab.
Mm. So here's why this is terrible. One, this announcement came out of nowhere. So it's just going to like drop in people's laps and be like, oh, here it is. Two, most of the reports about this game have been like, I don't know if it's going to be good. Three, I don't think multiplayer is really the focus of Devil's Third.
It might be.
So imagine if, say, Rise of the Tomb Raider came out and you could play the multiplayer for free. Who would? And also, would that be the best way to like introduce people to your game and get a good first impression of it? Like, this does not seem like a good idea to me at all. It's just going to make people like, oh, I don't give a shit about this. This is like mediocre multiplayer. I don't care.
I'm sticking with it. It is Shadow Man 64, the multiplayer game. Was there multiplayer in Shadow Man?
No, but I found this out because I almost bought it, but then I was like, no, I can't do this to myself.
No, don't buy Shadow Man.
No, yeah, there's a Shadow Man release on Steam. You can get Shadow Man for like $3 or something.
Yeah, because that was Acclaim.
Mm-hmm.
Because someone bought out. I actually was diving deep into the history of Acclaim the past week, and I guess I forget who technically owns that right now because they still exist. As just to parse out royalties and nothing else. It's really, really
like
weird.
A shell company. That's weird.
Yeah. Yeah. Toot toot! Project Cars! Xbox One? You better believe it. PlayStation 4? Oh, what a great day. The PC? It had some issues. The Wii U? Canceled! That's right. According to Slightly Mad Studios studio lead Ian Bell, here's his quote. The official line is that we're awaiting an announcement from Nintendo on new hardware. As of now, P-Cars, you shouldn't have shortened that, man. You shouldn't.
P-Cars.
is simply too much for the Wii U. So no P-Car on Wii U? is this really a surprise, Steve?
No. I mean, last time we checked in on the Wii U progress, they basically said that it was like running at the same frame rate as your history professor's PowerPoint presentation. Just not okay.
Scrolling text. Here's my thing. I don't even think I would want to play it on the Wii U, and because the controller wouldn't be right. Unless they use the right stick as an accelerator and turn it. You know what I'm talking about?
Does it have Mario Kart for the Wii plastic steering wheel support?
Oh my god, that'd be amazing.
You could finally use that thing again.
I'm just saying, the problem is that with the triggers, it's yes or no. There is no degree to the triggers on the Wii U, so it would just be like, we're going 150 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Unless you use the right stick to do the whole 360 degrees.
I mean, I guess if I played car games, which I don't unless that car game is Burnout.
Mario Kart. Burnout.
Yeah, I like goofy car games, but I don't play like real car simulator games. So, I mean, if I did, I would probably play it on the Wii U just because that's the only thing I own, but
Real Car Simulator 2016 is like drive real life. Toot toot! I totally agree with you. It's not the proper venue for that product, for that experience, for that interactive engagement.
Toot toot.
Toot toot! Street Fighter V got a brand new character, Nekali. I like that name. He has dreadlocks, he looks like a wild man, and according to Capcom, players who enjoy straightforward, hard-hitting character, will feel right at home with Nicali, as he possesses a wide variety of savage, close-range attacks, as well as a command grab, all with the goal of demolishing his foes. It's cool to see finally a fighter that's ready to take out his opponent in Street Fighter, instead of all those friendshipalities and all that shit. That they were putting in there.
So this, is this guy like a Blanka T-Hawk hybrid or something?
Here's my issue with him. He has these big dreadlocks, and I found them to be overly distracting to the point where in competitive play, I think people would have to choose the costume where it's not doing that because there's just too much frames of animation. Mm-hmm. I'm worried it might slow down the game. I don't know. He looks okay. Also worth noting that the beta for Street Fighter V went up this weekend, and then it went back down, and now it's having a bunch of issues, and Capcom has been like, hey, you know, hang tight, buddy. You might get on there, or maybe not. Hey, so it's a real beta, at least. You know?
It exists.
I almost went out and got myself a beta code before the news broke. I went, never mind. Because there are ways. There are ways.
If I was Capcom, I would just replace, like, when you try to load up the beta, I would just have a splash screen with the Street Fighter logo and then Hold On by Wilson Phillips playing in the background.
Oh, that's a good song, though. That's really I want good. That played at my wedding. okay, Hideo Kojima, he's out of Konami, apparently. Who knows what's actually going on there. Guillermo del Toro, he's a very large man. He rolls his way into Hollywood every year with some magic. Apparently, they were going to work on P.T., the Silent Hills game. P.T. was the precursor to Silent Hills, the project between Kojima and Guillermo del Toro. And according to Guillermo del Toro, they're still going to work together. Here's a quote from him. We are still in touch. We are still friends and working into doing something together, but that's not going to be Silent Hills. We were in the planning stages when it was canceled, and it's a shame it's not going to happen. When we were talking about really pushing the boundaries of the new consoles and making the game really mess with your head, one of the great moments in Metal Gear Solid was Psycho Mantis. The idea of that game can actually interact with you and stuff like that. You know, every time I hear it...
Is that your Marlon Brando that you're doing there?
He just sounds like a chubby French guy to me. I know he's not French, but he always sounds like a French guy.
Well, Guillermo del Toro, that's great that you want to keep working on video games, but here's the thing with Guillermo del Toro. He is the Peter Molyneux of film.
Oof.
He makes some good stuff. But more often than not, he talks too much and he overpromises on things that he cannot deliver on.
I could say he talks too much. He never shuts up.
Is that a botchamania?
Yeah, totally botchamania. The fucking Cena talks too much scenes. I mean, my thing with Del Toro is he needs to get involved with video games because the only game with his name is Toro, the bullfighting simulator. So if he wants to pick that back up, honestly, okay, enough of the jokes. He has a history with video games. Remember Insane that was going to get published by THQ and that didn't happen. Now Silent Hills, that's not going to happen. If I were him, focus all efforts on releasing a video game because it's third strike, you're out, buddy. Let's get this going. As for Kojima, like, that's where it gets a little weird because obviously he's not with Konami. What kind of publisher would pick this up? Honestly, I think someone like EA or Ubisoft would be insane to pass up this opportunity to be like, from the director of Metal Gear and Pacific Rim and Collide. In fact, just put them on the box hanging out at a Starbucks and they'll sell millions of copies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, man. PT still got on my PlayStation 4.
You can call your game Quiet Mountains.
Okay.
It's a good idea. You can have that one, Kojima. That one's on me.
All right. Toot toot! Nintendo is preparing Super Mario Maker, which will be released on, the day after September 10th of this fall.
Never forget.
And the day before September 12th, they will be hosting a hackathon over at Facebook HQ. Facebook does these things called hackathons. They're like, hey, everybody stop working for a minute. Make something weird. Show it to us. Mm-hmm. Maybe it'll turn out to be something. Nintendo is going to be joining in on that fun, saying, hey, everybody here, why don't you make a stage over here in this Mario Maker game? And if it's crazy and we're like, whoa, we'll put it in the game. Which is really cool.
It's smart. And if they play their cards right, Mario Maker could be huge. Huge. Like, as big as the Wii U itself. No, honestly, like, it could have one of the strongest attach rates if you get, whether it's like Facebook hackathon people or famous game devs or celebrities or YouTube people, and you curate content on, like, here's all the user shit. So, you know, something that's a little bit more robust than, say, the system for finding levels in Little Big Planet or something.
Right.
Which can be a mess. If you curate it really well and you have these featured things on there, people are going to want to play it. Like, even if you don't have a Wii U and you don't have a ton of interest in it, if you see, oh, PewDiePie just made a level.
Never going to happen.
No, I know it's never going to happen because they got beef. But I'm just saying, like, that's the kind of thing where kids will be like, Mom, PewDiePie made a video game. I'm going to get it.
He's just turning into Cartman.
That's what little kids sound like. It's true.
Mm-hmm.
So, well, that's huge.
I honestly, that's one of my most anticipated games this fall. Mm-hmm. But last year, one of my most anticipated games was the Master Chief Collection. So I'm just going to keep lowering those expectations because I bet you it'll launch and be completely broken and Mario's head's going to be missing. And then they're going to have to release the patch called Mario's Head is Missing. And you're going to have to go to New York City and learn about geography. And it's going to suck. It's going to suck.
So the real trick is the guy who's going to win is the guy who creates a Mario level. And then when you beat it at the end, it leaks all of your private information. And then if you have a pseudonym for a name, it won't let you change it and it bans you.
Toot toot! Odin Sphere. One of the classic, though underrated, JRPGs on the PS2, released in 2008, 2 years after the PlayStation 3 launched, so there's a reason not a whole lot of people played it.
So good.
Published, or developed by Atlus, published by Square Enix, is getting an HD remaster, and will be released on January 14th. Odin Sphere Lifter, and it's going to be published by Atlus, which is crazy. Crazy.
I'm very excited for this, because that's definitely one of the games where, when I think about games that could actually use an HD remake, that could be made better by new hardware,
right,
that's the first thing that comes to mind. It should have been a PS3 game. Like, yeah. There's no question about it. It's beautiful, it's a lot of fun, and it runs like ass.
Yeah.
When there's too much on the screen. And there's a couple of games like that. I know I had problems with slowdown Muramasa the Demon Blade on the Wii.
Ooh, yeah.
Which I got a little sluggish at times, but I think that got a remake on the Vita.
It did.
Which I didn't play, but I'm assuming they fixed some of those problems. Another one is Grim Grimoire.
Oh, my God.
Which is aesthetically similar to Odin Sphere. And
yeah.
Again, same problem where if there was too much going on the screen, you'd get slowed down because it was such a visually striking
game. I thought that was a UK-only release. Mm. Whoa.
You got it, man. You could borrow it sometime.
Oh my God! Maybe I'll borrow it from the internet. Odin Sphere, the remaster, will be coming to the PlayStation 4, PlayStation 3, and Vita. Toot toot. 10 years after the fact, we finally have an update to Knights of the Old Republic 2. Yes, the game that always had a little bit of issue. Developed by Obsidian. The latest patch, which literally comes 10 years after the game was released, includes Steam Workshop support, achievements, controller support, native widescreen resolution support. It supports up to 5K monitors, you nutjobs, and Steam Cloud saves, as well as it's been designed to incorporate the Sith Lord's restored content mod a little easier. This mod, of course, basically revised a lot of the environments and storylines that were actually taken out of the game, but were still on the disc, are still in the game's code, where it's like, well, we don't want to take the time to actually, like, balance this, so fuck it, put it out, because it has to be out before Christmas. So, very good news right there.
Only took them a decade to fix that game.
A toot toot. PlayStation 4 is finally getting a dedicated media remote. I just read that headline verbatim, because PDP is going to release a $30 remote that includes all the buttons, and, yeah.
I guess, and I'm not trying to be a cynic here or anything.
What's wrong?
I never understood the media remote.
Why?
Like, I guess it made sense. I had a few friends who had them for the PlayStation 2 because it was really sold as, like, a DVD player and a new PlayStation, so it kind of made sense. But now we're to the point where, I mean, do you really, is it so hard to hit X on the controller for play and pause?
Oh, it really is.
Is it that bad?
Oh, my thumb. It doesn't feel good on that controller I use all the time. I need a remote. Oh, much better. It also will include a share button, which, of course, you cannot share Blu-ray movies or Netflix or any streaming media.
So what the hell's the point?
Well, maybe you're playing your game, and that share button is just so far away.
Here's a better idea, Sony. You ready for this? Firmware update that supports universal remotes.
Oh, jeez. You know, the guy that took care of that, his dog got sick, so we're gonna have to delay that indefinitely. Toot toot! If you own NHL 15, you will be able to get into the beta for NHL 16. It goes from July 30th to August 6th. Toot toot! Five Nights at Freddy's has missed its release date, instead jumping 2 weeks ahead. According to the developer Scott Cawthon, okay, so as many of you already know, I'm bad with the release dates. The game is finished, and it is available only on Steam, not phones yet. It is supposedly the last chapter in the Five Nights at Freddy's storyline.
Mm-hmm. It looks different this time around, too. Like, you're not watching TV monitors or anything like that. You're
It's in a house.
Yeah, you're like a little kid in a house, and there's, I don't know. But it's still basically just Night Trap.
It really, really is.
Night Trap with bears.
All right. That's the end of the hype train. All aboard and prepare to exit towards the way of the chart park, which we will get to after this. Stay tuned. Bytes, Steve. Bytes. We talk about bits in the pressure cast. We talk about all the latest bit systems. How many bits does the PlayStation 4 have, or the Xbox One have, or your home PC? A lot. Do you like bits?
I love bits. I love them in increments of 8 and 16 and 64, mostly.
I love those, too. But what about bytes? Why did we forget about bytes?
Oh, man.
Simpler days. Luckily, NatureBox.com didn't forget about the bytes. They're bringing them back in a variety of flavors, including pistachio, power clusters, or more importantly, mango almond bytes. Apple pie oat clusters, or more importantly, blueberry almond bites. How about some pineapple coconut bars, or more importantly, cranberry almond bites? That's right, it pays to bite for free at naturebox.com. You go to naturebox.com, you fill out a little bit of information, they say, okay, buddy, here are 5 pre-selected snacks we're sending your way for free from NatureBox. Your satisfaction is, ooh, it's guaranteed. Ooh, they're going to get you. They're going to get you to eat these delicious snacks, and you're going to be happy about it. You're going to be snacking smarter. You're going to be snacking healthier. You're going to be biting the bites. You're going to be biting the bars.
You will never be more satisfied.
Never, ever. And these are good snacks, too. They got health officials there. They're looking over these snacks, and they're going, yeah, this is delicious, but is this good for you? And if it checks both areas of good for you and taste good, then they just send it right out, baby. There ain't no holding back. That is naturebox.com. Sign up today for 5 free pre-selected snacks shipped right to you. naturebox.com. Ah, yes. It's always a pleasure to get off the hype train and just make our way down to that glorious, beautiful environment outside, known as the Chart Park, the land where money grows on trees. Yes, the Chart Park. This is the part of the show where we find out which fat cats of Wall Street will tip their top hats towards Lady Luck as we investigate the latest business and financial news in the video game industry, including, well, legal news this week. Let's start it off
exciting.
With Xbox. Yes, Xbox. Microsoft revealed that they have sold 1.4 million Xbox consoles in the fourth quarter, which is up compared to last year's 1.1 million sold. Good for them.
That's not bad. How many of those came from Japan?
Japan.
Literally 100.
Probably about. We'll get into that in a bit. This is definitely good news for Microsoft. It does seem like it was a guaranteed shift was going to take place because they have been getting more exclusives. I'm more concerned about Sony this fall. If they don't have those things that can match, you know, hey, here's Gears. Hey, here's Forza. Hey, here's Halo. Hey, here's Tomb Raider. And they're like, we've got Uncharted. We got this weird horror game called Until Dawn. Anybody?
We got more Uncharted.
I guarantee Xbox is going to do a bang-up job this holiday. It's also cheaper.
It is cheaper, which will help.
Yeah, man. It looks cool as shit, too. It's a good system. It's totally rad. Moving over to some bad news from the old industry itself. John Smedley of Daybreak Games, he was the president of Daybreak Games. He kind of he had some issues with some hackers known as the old Lizard Squad.
Mm.
And he might have called them dirtbags and pieces of garbage. And because of that, well, his games all experienced DDoS attacks. And it's gotten so bad to the point where he is stepping down as president.
That sucks.
Yes.
Well, because he's right, and it's nice to have a dev actually, like, speaking out and not being afraid of these, you know, little kids.
COO Russell Shanks is going to be taking over as president. Here is a quote from Daybreak Games. I can confirm that John Smedley will be taking some time off from the company for the near term and transitioning into a different role to be determined. So he's not gone.
That's good.
But he definitely needs some time off because that sounds
good.
Like
he should
hell.
Take that time to talk mad shit about Lizard Squad.
Yeah, I don't know. His mailboxes are going to start exploding, you know. moving over, we also have another person leaving, Tomas Gop. He, of course, was the executive producer for the upcoming Lords of the Fallen 2 from CI Games. He has parted ways with the company. According to him, I want to respect CI's will to keep that, the reasons for their parting, between me and them. I wanted all the best for Lords, but there's going to be someone else leading the project, and we'll see if it will make more sense than I could. I made up my mind a couple days ago. We just wanted to figure out the best way, the best communication for both sides. Oh, The way he phrases that was like, I wanted all the best for it, but we're parting ways. This sounds a lot like we were talking about last week.
With Jaeger games?
With Jaeger, and I already forgot what game that was.
Dead
Island 2. There we go.
Mm.
So, not good.
They must not be happy with it. Although, I mean, I wonder what he's mad about. Like, because the first Lords of Fallen game, it was, if I remember correctly, it's basically just Dark Souls.
Much easier version of Dark Souls.
Okay.
Which had some interesting, it had a better plot, I'll say, than Dark Souls. You know, plot, like a direct plot that communicates to you. But I just didn't feel great.
Yeah, so is he upset because the sequel isn't going to be Dark Souls-y enough, or did he want to innovate more, or I guess we can't really speculate, we just have to see when it comes out, but it'll be interesting to see.
We can speculate. He was very mad because he wanted to be more like the original version of Hamtaro, where it was more about just hanging out and having goofy adventures, and not so serious as later renditions of Hamtaro were. I mean, all the best to him and his fuzzy pals.
Mm-hmm.
This is just an assumption. Hamtaro was definitely the breaking point for him in CI Games. Lords of the Fallen 2, of course, has no release date or anything like that. The first one was developed by an entirely different developer who also parted ways. So it sounds like they're really focused on this title to fit into a certain parameter for them.
Mm-hmm.
And apparently any deviation from that requires companies to go elsewhere.
Seems like a pleasant place to work.
It does, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Ubisoft has had another shakeup over in the UK involving Alex Friend. He used to work at Warner Brothers. Now he's going to be taking over the Assassin's Creed series.
Oh boy, now they can be even more broken.
Awkward. Holly Cooper, she was involved in the field sales team at Ubisoft. She'll be taking over as a PR executive. And David Burrows, he was the junior PR executive. No, not anymore. He's now being bumped up to a PR executive. So two new PR executives over in the UK Ubisoft team, which the UK is a very important area for Ubisoft. They are a European developer, you know.
Mm-hmm.
They are French, and they develop in France. That's what they do. Mobile developer Gree, who have put out such classic titles as Modern War and Crime City, just, you know, really direct names.
Yeah.
I mean,
bastions of innovation.
It just sounds like Atari 2600 titles. I don't know, Crime City. Mm-hmm. The city of the crimes.
Well, I like to think that when you're developing a mobile game, after you decide which game you're going to clone, then you take all of the names of the top 10 popular mobile games currently.
Right.
And you take each individual word in the name, put it on a piece of paper, put it in a hat, and then you shuffle it around, and then you just pick two or three, and that's what you name it.
Theft Auto.
Yeah.
Call of
Crush.
Yeah.
Call of Candy.
Yeah.
Clash of Candy Clans.
Gree is laying off 30% of their Western workforce from their San Francisco offices. So, not great news. According to the COO, Andrew Shepard, today we made the difficult decision to reduce the workforce of Gree International Incorporated business by 30%. This was done to better align our operation with our development goals and business strategy. Several teams in San Francisco were impacted. We are working closely with each and every person to ensure the smoothest transition possible. Offices in other locations were not affected. Awkward. Corporate speak. Oh man, audio spike. Corporate. Whenever I say corporate, it just spikes.
Huh.
I know, it's weird. It's like they're trying to block me, man. Corporate. Hey, it didn't spike then. See, because I called them out. There you go. That's what's going on. Utrex, the amazing developer who brought us the most recent NASCAR game, the European developer, has lost another 22 jobs, yet all those jobs are going over to Zero Light. This Zero Light, of course, works on 3D visualization for the car industry. So when you want to see a car in 3D graphics, you go to Zero Light.
So apparently, like, this company is doing so well for themselves that 22 of their employees collectively said, we don't even want to make video games anymore.
We're done.
Yeah,
we just want to make the cars.
I just like the cars.
Yeah. Hopefully they'll be making some NASCARs over there. Life is strange. It sure is. But it gets a little better when you sell 1 million copies. That's right. Life is Strange has sold 1 million copies.
That's good. It's a nice little game.
That's a feel-good story. And that, of course, was published by Square Enix. So, let's move over to Square Enix boss, Yusuke Matsuda. Here's what he had to say about the current climate of new IPs. Get ready, Steve. Here we go. Softball heading your way here, buddy. Cultivating a new IP is very important. This is my own personal view, but I believe that it is very difficult to immediately build upon a big IP. Looking retrospectively at the game industry, many games take off or get their big break at their third title. There are cases where the opposite is true, of course. But regardless, you're going to need at least three games before you can tell whether an IP is going to be really successful or not. I call this my law of third titles. That's why, for the first and second games, you experiment to a degree where you can still be flexible, and if the series has grown enough to be able to expect a big hit for the third game, you can expand the scale. If the third title is a success, then all is well. Just real quick, want to point out, so new IP means three titles.
Yeah, I don't understand what he's saying. It's just like gross, slimy corporate stuff. So basically what he's saying is don't innovate. Just think about how your game can fit into like a three-part series, and you can't have self-contained pieces of art. You have to have these giant, disgusting, festering corporate shit piles.
Well, I mean, to be fair, this War of Mine is pretty good, but we're going to need to see at least two more.
Yeah, at least two more to like flesh that out.
Journey,
yeah.
Not bad. Going to need about two more.
Need a bigger Journey. What if there were open worlds and you could steal cars in Journey?
That would be, oh my God, that'd be like Jack and Dexter 2, which is like the best one they ever did.
So Journey, it's an open world, but the only way you can reveal more of the map is if you scale these towers.
Right.
And then when you get to the top, you activate like the sensor at the top. And then you can see more of the map.
Oh my God, that is perfect. I mean, Square Enix does know a thing about, you know, releasing, titles and new IPs. I mean, Tomb Raider sold only 8.5 million units, and they call that a disappointment. Mm-hmm. So they know a thing or two about new IP, even though that's old IP. RIP. New IP. You know, like that?
Yeah, if this guy is so proud of his law that he apparently invented here.
Don't fight the law, Steve. The law wins.
What's the most successful Square new IP for the past 5 years?
See here. You're trying to trick me. And there's a mobile version of Final Fantasy IV, which you can download.
Yeah, the answer here is they don't have one, so why should we listen to what they have to say?
Hey, they got that, what is that, RPG Factory? They announced that Square Enix thing. Remember that there's called an RPG Factory? It's like, oh, no. Well, they do have one new IP that's going to be coming out. I forget the name of it, but they showed off concept art during E3. Mm-hmm.
But it's not out yet. I mean, and Square is notorious for doing this, where they tease things, and then it takes them years and years and years for them to come out. And they also like to suckle at the teat of Final Fantasy, and they don't really innovate a lot. So I have no clue why they would be talking about new IPs when they literally don't have any.
And the worst part is Square's teat It's Barrett's.
Mm-hmm. Oh, it's Barrett's teeth.
It's Barrett's. He's got his machine gun arm. I am really looking forward to that Final Fantasy remake. I can't help it.
Nerd.
Moving over to Nintendo. They won a lawsuit. That's right. There was Quintel Research Group. They had a patent in 2008 for a computerized information retrieval system. It was supposed to be a rectangular shape and portable. And they were like, hey, the DS and the 3DS, you can't do that. We got the patent on that. Yes, 2008.
A patent on a square that has electronics in it? That's...
of course, they had to sue them for, breaking their patent in, 1989 with the Game Boy.
Mm-hmm.
But, of course, they lost. Nintendo won. And according to Nintendo's lawyers, the result in this case continues to prove that Nintendo will vigorously defend its innovations against patent lawsuits and will not pay to settle cases simply to avoid litigation. Very true. They have gone to court and fought everybody. Of course, one of the most famous cases was over the case of Donkey Kong and King Kong against, Universal Pictures, where Universal Pictures had to admit they won a lawsuit against RKO and did not actually own King Kong.
That's the best thing in the world, too. They didn't know that they didn't own King Kong.
And the last name of the lawyer that won that case? Kirby. Who is then named, a pink ball that dances. And honestly, if I go out, I want a blue ball. No one listened to that part. Please ignore that part. Please delete that part from your podcast.
If somebody makes a video game about every Saturday night for Colin.
Okay. Yeah, well, Friday night's all right for fighting, but Saturday night's...
Saturday night's all right for blue balls.
It's true. It's not all right, but...
It's reality, man.
It's right. That's an accurate assessment. That's right. Let's get over to the UK. Video games in the UK. Here they are in the top 10 list. Number 10 is The Witcher 3 Wild Hunt. Number 9 is God of War 3 Remastered, which is its debut. In 9th place.
Oof.
It was a budget title, by the way.
Wah, wah, wah.
Number 8 is The Elder Scrolls Online. Number 7 is Call of Duty Advanced Warfare. Number 6 is Destiny. Number 5 is Grand Theft Auto 5. Number 4 is Lego Jurassic World. Please get this shit off your fucking list, UK. That game is awful. Number 3 is Batman Arkham Knight. Number 2 is F1 2015, which had first place last week. And number 1, the new entry, Rory McIlroy PGA Tour.
He did it. Round of applause for Colin.
I practiced, no joke, a bunch of times before doing a video.
McMuffin.
Of course, that game is getting just horrible reviews.
Rocky McMuffin's getting bad reviews?
Rocket McMuffin. That's amazing. It's getting like fours and stuff. I played it and I didn't think it was great or anything, but I had enough fun. I didn't think it was great. Some amazing glitches coming out of that game that involved like Rory with his knees to his chest sitting on the floor and then slowly rising like Slender Man to pick up his golf club. Amazing.
That's creepy.
It's very creepy. Let's go over to the cursed land of trains that is Japan to see what are the 10 best-selling games over there in Japan. Trains. Number 10 is Mario Kart 8. Number 9 is Minecraft PlayStation Vita Edition. Number 8 is Taiko Drum Master 5. Number 7 is Rhythm Heaven the Best Plus. Number 6 is the Fire Emblem games, if you want to call them Fates, both of them combined together. Number 5 is Splatoon, still holding its own. Number 4 is Dai Ace Attorney Naruhodo Ryusuke Noboken. Noboken! Number 3.
No Boken's here, baby.
No, they have the word Boken and they got the line through it. The red line, like no smoking. No Boken. You smoking? No Boken. What are you smoking? No Boken. Number 3 is Yoshi's Woolly World. Number 2 is Batman Arkham Knight. Huh.
That's weird.
Huh. And number 1 is Yo-Kai Watchbusters. I Kaneko Dan Shiru Satai.
That's a lot of Nintendo on the top 10.
Yeah. Yeah. Weird. Where's Microsoft? Let's find out with the best-selling hardware in Japan. Coming in at first place, the top of the best-selling systems is the PlayStation 4 with 22,380, new Nintendo 3DS LL, 19,939, Wii U with 12,204, PlayStation Vita with 12,174, new Nintendo 3DS with 4,187, PlayStation 3 with 2,513, Nintendo 3DS with 2,335, Nintendo 3DS LL with 7,794. Really? That's it?
Yeah. Oh.
PlayStation Vita TV with 427. And in last place is the Xbox One with 183.
Oh, wow.
And that's
almost 200.
That's it, man. That's it for the Chart Park. We're going to have to get out of here. The Chart Park.
The land where money grows and trees.
Are you adding a little bit more on top of that for the fan club there?
No, I had a little something in my throat.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. How much time we got left?
Well, we're making good time. We're making great time.
Real quick, wait, let's just talk about the games of the week real quick because I totally forgot to do that segment. We're going to do it right here.
All right, let's do it.
How to Fool Boyfriend.
It's cool. It's a pigeon dating game.
Okay. We're doing the games of the week. How to Fool Boyfriend. It is a visual novel. Visual novels, in case you've never played one, are essentially adventure games where there's not much interaction. You kind of like a choose your own adventure book. Literally, it is just static images, no animation or anything, and then just text with characters talking to each other. And How to Fool Boyfriend, you play as a girl going to a gifted pigeon school. And so everyone is birds. The teachers are birds, your classmates are birds, and you can even see them if you want as like attractive anime boys, if that's what you're into. I gotta say, I have played a lot of visual novels, which is weird to say that out loud, but it's true. I played X-Plays, I played Haikuki, Stories of the Shinshin-Gumi, which is funny because I got a comment after I finished recording the video, someone saying, God, how is this even a game? Like, you were talking about Haikuki as soon as I got done with this one. They should just call it a book and put it on tablets. This is insane. But over in Japan, they're quite popular. My thing is, visual novels have a lot of padding, and they're all pretty bad. You know, How to Fool Boyfriend, you might just say, oh, you just like it because there's pigeons. No. What it does really well is it takes bite-sized chunks of the story and gives you very small decisions and a very small cast of characters. Whereas in other visual novels, it's like, and then there's this character, and then there's like the girl version of this character, and then there's the evil version of this character. It's imagine like just Sonic the Hedgehog over the past 10 years, like that type of storytelling.
All of his friends.
But How to Fool Boyfriend does just a brilliant job of saying like, hey, here's all your classmates, and we're going to introduce them in very small conversations. I mean, like literally, like conversations will take place over the course of 3 minutes, whereas in other visual novels, it'll literally be 17 minutes of being like, are you sure? Yeah, I'm sure. Well, you're wrong. Are you sure? Yeah, you're wrong. Oh, you're right. No, you're wrong. Yes, I'm right. Like, they just talk in circles, and it's just fucking garbage. This game is kind of like, hey, we're going to have the summer festival. Hey, remember these three characters? The one that's really, like, uppity? The one that's, you know, very, like, he's got a lot of charisma and he's coming towards you, you know? Or maybe even your teacher are all going to the summer festival. Who do you want to go talk to? And then you just hang out with them and you learn a little bit about them. And within 2 minutes, boom, you're back in class. And then it's kind of like, hey, you should pick up this book at a bookstore. So you go to the bookstore and then you bump into your teacher and you have a small little conversation. It develops very well. Excellent pace. Lots of fun. I think it's like $8 or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I had a lot of fun with it. I'm surprised. Yeah. And yeah, they're pigeons, but you get to know these characters and they're all really interesting.
It's on Steam as well, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Yeah, but play it on the Vita because I'm on Vita.
Because you love Vita. You got to play something on your Vita. What are you playing on your Vita right now?
Not a football fun.
Is this made by a Western dev?
It is not. It actually was from Japan.
It is from
Digital
Japan.
Devolver actually published it in the United States. Mm. Translation, wow, it's really great.
Good.
And there's lots of bird puns, which is...
That's the best.
Well, and my favorite is they got this one bird who literally just says cuckoo and it didn't translate into English and he's just insane. And when he's introduced, he's stomping on pudding and says it's not real pudding. And it's obviously real pudding. Oh, and he's also on like the track field. So he's just, he's supposed to be running and instead he's stomping on pudding and freaking out. Wonderful. Other game I played, real quick, Tembo, the Badass Elephant, which is developed by Game Freak, the people that have developed every goddamn Pokemon game in the main series, including X and Y, all the way back to Red and Blue. They have made a platformer that stars an elephant who...
Would you describe him as badass?
He is, because this general city is under attack by the Shadow organization, and so he recalls when him and this elephant worked together in the jungle, so he calls up the elephant, he gets dropped off, and you collect peanuts, and you fight all these guys, and that's what it is. Here's the problem with this game. I know, we're already getting into what the problem is. The game is basically a simple platformer, but it has very stiff controls. So when you jump in the air, you like have to press attack, your attack's going to send you to the ground. And that's just not really a natural instinct for me. So oftentimes I actually fling him lower than I want him to.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can dash by double tapping forward, which is great. But you know, occasionally I'll accidentally press once again the wrong button and have him fling upward and do his uppercut attack. It's just a very traditional platformer. I wish I could get into more detail, but like it's seems like something that might be on the Sega Genesis in 1994. whatever. He can fill up his trunk with water and he can put out fires, and that's kind of cool. But really, the enemies have no personality. And because they have no personality, it's hard to care when you're smashing up their helicopters or their tanks or just individual soldiers. I mean, they tell you whenever you start off a level, here's how many civilians you can save. And when you save the civilians, they jump on your back and they go, wee! And that's really fun. But the enemies, they say how many enemies there are. But there's no real incentive to get all of them except to have the number go down. And then the boss fights, you just button mash. It's really lousy. It's weird because some other enemies will be shooting bombs at you and you have to knock them back and blow them up. But with the boss fights, it's just smashing them as fast and hard as you can.
Mm-hmm.
So, no.
That sucks because I was watching this one. I was like, you know, maybe I'll pick it up because it's a cool developer and it looks like you know, it's a nice looking game. Aesthetically, it's
beautiful.
Very nice.
Yeah. And I would say that I would love to see an animated series based off of Tembo, the badass elephant, but I don't want to play his game.
So maybe I should just watch a playthrough of it?
I don't know.
Maybe I should just watch a first hour video?
I would recommend that. I mean, if you went to like maybe, I don't know, youtube.com/videogamesaredumb and you found that video, maybe.
A good place to start.
Best game of the week, though, DK Jungle Swing. Go look up that video. It's a Wii U DS title, and it's just so much fun. You just play Donkey Kong. You swing around. You have a good time. It's fucked up. It's great.
It's fucked up, man.
It's fucked up, man. I mean, it, you know, it used to be on the DS, and now they've enlarged it onto the Wii U.
Mm-hmm.
But what if we did the opposite of that? What if we stepped away from the games of the week and we got tiny? It's time for Pocket Talk. This is where we discuss all the mobile developments in the game industry.
It's the segue of the week.
That's right. Starting off with Fallout Shelter finally coming to Android on August 13th.
Yay.
Yeah, I guess people are really sick of that game already. So I'm like, fuck.
No, there's a Bloomberg article about how it made so much money in the first 2 weeks. And after that first 2 weeks, like the numbers just tanked.
Bloombergs.
But that's cool. I mean, if you want to make $5 million off a, you know, little mobile game in 2 weeks, that's pretty cool.
I have to wonder if this was supposed to be out at E3 and they just came into some difficulties, because I can't imagine that this was a choice. They're like, no, we'll launch on iOS and then Android.
Yeah, the only thing I can think of is they signed some sort of exclusivity deal for a couple of months, but
maybe.
Seems weird.
I imagine that it was just kind of like, oh shit, there's so many fucking different Android devices, whereas iOS, it's like iPad, iPad 2, iPad Air, iPhone.
Yeah, there's
iPhone
probably a lot
Plus.
More optimization that goes into it.
Optimism vaccine.
Optimvaccine.com.
Of course, Fallout Shelter was the fourth most downloaded app game on iOS in June. Cooking Fever. I've got it. You've got it. That's right. Cooking Fever, the Lithuanian game. Well, it's from Lithuania. It was developed by NordCurrent. They've surpassed 50 million downloads, and they even mentioned that 5% of all of Australia has played their game.
That's weird.
Crikey.
I haven't even heard of that one. Like, I haven't played it at all.
Well, all right, obviously you don't hang around a grade school cafeteria, so let me fill you in. You've got a fever for cooking, and there's only one way to get it done, and that is on your mobile device. I didn't play it either. I'm sorry.
Huh. I've been playing Alpha Bear on the bus. That's my go-to.
Is that that's a mobile game, huh?
Yeah. So it's going back to the games of the
week. No. We're in Pocket Talk. This is
Pocket Talk. Yeah. Okay. So it's basically there's this bear on the screen, and then there's like letter tiles that are surrounding him, and you have to make a word out of the letter tiles. So like Scrabble type of stuff. Each letter tile also has a number on it that goes down by one every turn that you take, and if it gets down to zero before you use that letter in a word, then it turns into a rock, and rocks are bad because that takes up a letter spot, so then you have fewer letters to make words, etc., etc. And then the best part about it is at the very end, you get like a random picture of a bear, and the bear is saying a random thing. And when I say random, I mean like literally just gobbledygook.
Right.
And then you can share that. So it's just like, you know.
I think the video game industry could use more bears.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean.
So yeah, like I saw, like people have been sharing their bear pictures on Twitter. And
oh,
they're
I love
like,
some bear pictures.
It's just like, I have a patella tumor.
Ew.
And then it's just like, here's this bear holding some balloons. It's pretty cool.
Awesome. Bears.
Bears. Alpha Bears.
Okay. Is that really what it's called?
Yeah, it's called Alpha Bear. It's great. It's really good. Awesome bus game. Really makes you think, too.
Awesome bus game of the week. Well, okay, so we just talked about Cooking Fever. We just talked about Alpha Bear, which Alpha Brain, great product. Definitely invest in that. Now let's talk about Candy Crush, as Britain's Got Talent, and they've also got a favorite game. Candy Crush, the number one most favorite game amongst over 2,000 Britons who were surveyed. Candy Crush, number one game. That means it beat out Grand Theft Auto, FIFA, Civilization, Call of Duty, Football Manager. None could compare.
What about Crumpet Crush?
Crumpet
Crush. Hey, joke of the week.
It is. Real quick, Apple made $11 billion in profit in the third quarter. Not bad.
Pretty good.
They didn't release any numbers on the Apple Watch.
Mm.
And lastly, Threes has doubled its revenue by simply releasing a free version. That's right, Threes, that amazing game that was ripped off by those bastards, has now got a free version. According to Asher Vollmer, we released a free version of Threes game 1 month ago, and here's how it's doing. It has doubled our daily income. Thank you for playing. Smiley face.
So is the free version just have like ad support on the bottom, like banner ads?
Yeah, it's basically like Crossy Road.
Okay, you know? That's a really good model because, I mean, it's a good way to get extra money, but it's not exploitative, and you're not, like, taking advantage of your player base, so that's a good thing. And I think we finally reached the point where there's a freemium model that isn't gross.
Yeah.
And I don't know if you can sell an iOS game now for actual money.
I just wish that we had a word that wasn't gross, like freemium.
Yeah.
I don't know.
But yeah, I think the days of, like, success from things like Ridiculous Fishing and Monument Valley, it's probably in the past. I think you got to make your game free, unfortunately. Better for worse?
Yes. You got to have the big picture. Because we are exiting out of Pocket Time.
Make a noise. Make a noise.
Let's take the mushroom.
You sound like one of the pigeons from Had a Full Boyfriend.
Yes. Pigeons. I thought that they were as smart as golden retrievers.
Mm-hmm.
Turns out those were ravens.
Oh,
I got mixed up.
You got mixed up.
Yeah, but they have actually trained ravens to actually clean up the streets. It's kind of insane. In exchange for peanuts. Because they built a vending machine that accepts quarters. So the pigeons are flying around looking, or the ravens are flying around looking for quarters over in Boston. Fascinating story. Pigeons, on the other hand, dumb as a box of rocks.
Mm.
But they're not as stupid as the idiot of the week. This week was a slow news week. Can you tell? Did you listen to the episode, folks? Not a whole lot going on. In fact, there were Pocket Talk where there should have been the other thing. I had to swap out stories just to pad out some things. All that's going to be fixed, though, because August, holy crap, games coming out, lots of news. So this idiot of the week is a little bit of a stretch. WWE 2K16 will no longer include Hulk Hogan. And they are the idiot. No, they are not. 2K Games had to get rid of him because Hulk Hogan was fired by the WWE. Because
racism mania is running wild, brother.
Let's break down the story real quick. In 2008, Hulk Hogan was, you know, plowing his best friend's wife. Oh, and don't get me wrong, his best friend was into it. The love sponge encouraged him to go for it because he was going through a divorce. Mm. Little did the Hulkster know that there was a secret camera filming his beautiful encounter. In 2012, Gawker said, hey, let's make people vomit on their way to work. So they put up the entire sex video, or what they thought was the entire sex video, on their Gawker website. Hulk Hogan, brother, he didn't care for people seeing his naked ass. So he actually...
his tan, leathery hide.
Oh my God. I've seen pictures. I will not lie. And
he's got the same... he looks like a rotisserie chicken. Like,
yeah. Yeah, I don't. Yeah, it kind of reminds me of like a muscular Hank Hill.
Mm-hmm. Well, Amanda always says that he looks like a hot dog because like his skin looks like a hot dog, and then he's always wearing like ketchup and mustard color clothes. So she actually like, you know those things you get them at like craft stores, but they're like the little like bead clothes. Things. They're like the bead things that you can like you can make a picture image thing with these colored beads, and then you melt them in the oven and it makes like a thing. You ever seen one of those?
No.
Like people sell stuff like this on Etsy all the time. They'll like make like pixel art Marios or something out of these little plastic hollow bead things. So Amanda bought a bunch of those, and then she made a magnet, and it's a hot dog with Hulk Hogan's face on it, and it's on her fridge. It's beautiful.
As God intended.
Yeah, my very talented girlfriend.
Yes.
Using her skills to do the Lord's work.
Honestly, that is a better story than what we're going to have to go into. So Hulk Hogan was mad that they had the sex tape on Gawker. Mm-hmm. He sued them for the modest sum of $100 million. The trial is starting up. And then the National Enquirer said, here's the whole story. The judge says to go through with the case, they need the entire video. And the entire video was not present on Gawker's website because this was also going to be part of Gawker being like, hey, we didn't show the whole video or whatever their legal claim was going to be. Yeah. So the National Enquirer said, we've got the whole video. And so, you know, after the postcoital, is that the right word?
Postcoital?
Postcoital, hello talk, the conversation. Hogan decided to talk about his daughter dating a black guy. And he never said black guy. He said the N-word a lot.
A whole bunch.
As Louis C.K. says, I just put that awful word in your head. Sorry. Like, literally talking about, like, how he would prefer if she was dating at least a black guy that was in the NBA, because that guy would at least have $800 million.
Well, and a lot of times when celebrities say horribly racist things, they immediately come back with, well, you know, it was out of context, and I'm not racist, but, which is still bad.
No.
But Hulk Hogan literally says, and I quote, I'm racist, to a point.
Yes.
End quote.
But nice guys are nice guys, or whatever he says in this whole quote. And also, keep in mind, when people say racist things, they usually say it on a talk show or something stupid, and everybody notices, hidden camera. No one else was there. He thought it was just him and this woman. And who the hell after sex is like, let me tell you how I feel about this entire race. Yeah. Let me generalize an entire race of people that have had the worst treatment in America for over, you know, the history of America, like the foundation of this country built on racism. Let me encourage that a bit because I don't like who my daughter's dating.
Well, I mean, Hulk Hogan is the, you know, human personification or human embodiment of America. And what's more American than institutionalized racism?
I mean, you've seen that Mr. America is returning to the WWE, right?
Oh, no.
No, that'd be great, though. Wouldn't it be great? So here's what a 2K spokesperson said. We are highly respectful of the way that our partners chose to run their business and manage our partnerships accordingly. We can confirm that Hulk Hogan will not appear in WWE 2K16. Why? Because the WWE literally erased him off of the website, any mention of him other than video, because that's part of the WWE network, entirely off their website, removed all the merchandise. He is no longer part of the company.
Gave him the Benoit.
Fired.
Oh,
yeah.
Benoit treatment. But yeah, this is, I think the most interesting part is, like, just going off on this racist rant, it's either pillow talk for him, or, like, maybe that's how he gets an erection, is being racist?
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah.
You know what gets me hard, brother? Segregation.
All the power. All the power.
Yeah.
You know.
Bad. Bad.
Dennis Rodman says he's not racist. Take that for what you will.
Dennis Rodman said Hulk Hogan's not racist.
Virgil says he's not racist.
Wait, Virgil? The Virgil?
The Virgil.
So the guy who Vince McMahon had a black manservant in the WWE.
Yes.
Okay.
Is Coco Beware still alive?
Yes. I think so. Pretty sure. Yeah.
Reach out for comment for him.
Mark Henry commented.
Oh, Mark Henry had the best comment where he's just like, I don't want to get into all this, but all right, here you go.
Yeah.
So, you know, is Hulk Hogan racist? Well, we'll leave that for you to decide. But he is most definitely the idiot
brother
of the week.
I deeply apologize for those statements. They do not represent my character.
Well done.
Oh, yes. His career is well done.
Mm-hmm.
Well done.
Yep. That hot dog's been thrown in the fire, baby.
Mm-hmm.
It's like when you microwave a hot
dog. Well, there's a lot of juice in that hot dog.
A lot of juice in it.
Right in the ass. That's where you put the needle.
Yeah, that's where Brutus the Barber Beefcake put the steroid needle.
Oh, yeah. Don't even get into that story. But before we wrap up this week's show, we have to look back to the past. I realize there's no music for this segment. I don't regret it. I like it. It's quiet. It's ambient. In this week in history, this is where we look at all the games released in the past. This week, what happened? I always go 10 years and back.
Mm-hmm.
I couldn't find anything compelling until 17 years ago.
Yeah, welcome to the end of July in the video game industry.
17 years ago in Japan, rival schools went onto the PlayStation.
Rival schools.
There you go. There's the sound effect. I love Rival Schools, my all-time favorite fighting games. And even a game where I have a buddy who does not play fighting games, hates fighting games, gets frustrated, will pause the game and walk away if there's too many fireballs. Not even kidding. He loves Rival Schools.
It's fun. It's a good, well, especially, again, I'm not a fighting game guy. I've said that multiple times. And it's a good button masher, fun game.
I like when you can play as Daigo. And his interference attack is he just stands in front and just takes the punches and just backhand, like, uses his backhand and slaps him a bunch of feet away. 18 years ago, Dragon Ball GT Final Bout came out on the PlayStation as one of the worst PlayStation titles, but also Herc's Adventure, the rare LucasArts game, which is fantastic. 22 years ago, Echo the Dolphin on the Genesis, a game that I never really liked but would not stop playing. Weird game.
Yeah, I think the reason I played that game was to figure out what it was, basically.
Is this game? No.
Yeah, I just remember, like, I remember playing it as a kid, and my dad just, like, standing behind me with his arms crossed, is just like, so when's the video game happen?
Oh, shit.
Like, oh!
Daddy did not approve.
No, I don't think he'd, like, gone home either.
Hmm. Well, here's the next part. You're going to love this. 24 years ago, over in the great country of Japan, UN Squadron hit the Super Nintendo.
Oh, I love that game.
There you go. There's one for you.
Bought it at a flea market for $2 a couple years ago.
How crazy is this? That was 24 years ago. 25 years ago, over in Japan, Mario got his doctorate as Dr. Mario. I never really liked Dr. Mario, to be honest. People love Dr. Mario. 26 years ago, the very first Mother was released in Japan, which is now known
as... Glenn Danzig?
Huh?
Glenn Danzig?
Mother! But of course, that is known as Earthbound Beginning, so that was the first Earthbound game. Mother, 26 years ago this week, 29 years ago, Solomon's Key. Come on, everybody's played this game. Might as well give it a toss.
Solomon's Key. You bought it at Funko Land in 1994 for 50 cents. It's Solomon's Key!
It's not a great game. It's not a bad game. It's a game.
It's a game. It exists. You bought it for 50 cents.
31 years ago, the Super Cassette Vision, yes, the console, in Japan, was released 31 years ago. But 34 years ago, so 3 years prior to that, on the exact same week, the Cassette Vision was released in Japan.
Ah, the Cassette Vision.
Hey, you know, it had a few good titles. It's a collector curio, and if you don't know the Cassette Vision, look it up. You're going to like it. It's fun. Funny. It's a funny system. But I think we need to close out the show! Steve, where can people reach you on the internet?
You can find me on Twitter, at Steve Cuff. That's at Steve C-U-F-F.
See you, friendly face! That's great. Yeah, what do you got coming up on ShepherdExpress.com this week?
I've got a couple of movie reviews. There's a review for Trainwreck. There's a review for Ant-Man. There's also going to be an article about Hulk Hogan that I think me and Steve Coleman are working on. So, and it's about how there's, you know, a big race issue in professional wrestling. So,
hey, man, The Rock was the first black champion. Yeah. Yeah. What's going on over at OptimismVaccine.com?
Hey, we've got the OpVacCast. We've got a new episode of that coming up on
the OpVacCast?
The OpVacCast, which you can find on iTunes, you can find it on Stitcher, you can find it on TuneIn Radio. You can just go and stream it directly from our website, OptimismVaccine.com. You can download an MP3 file, like super high quality MP3 file.
Do you have MP4 files?
No. Oh. Do you want those?
No, I just want to know I have the option. Just makes me feel better.
No, man. But yeah, we have a new episode of the OpVacCast that'll be up on Monday, and we also have a new-ish episode of Shotgun Wedding. That's our podcast where we have a central movie, and then our two guests on the show look at that central movie and try and decide what the best pairing with that movie would be. Mm. So our central movie was Commando, and we debate whether we should pair it with Hard Ticket to Hawaii or... I just saw you shake your head. Or Suburban Commando. Hulk Hogan tie-in.
Oh, God.
Spoiler alert, if you haven't seen Suburban Commando in the last 20 years, which you probably haven't, it's fucking unwatchable.
It's a movie about red lights and yellow lights. And are you man enough to deal with the yellow light?
Mm-hmm.
That's the arc. That is the arc. Of course, that's where the quote, "I was frozen today," came from.
Yeah, and if you haven't seen Hard Ticket to Hawaii, it is the apex of cinema.
Great, sure.
A guy gets his fingers cut off by a frisbee, and a guy that's like doing a handstand on a skateboard gets blown up by a missile launcher.
Fantastic film all around. Excellent. Definitely go and check out OptimismVaccine.com. But don't forget to go to youtube.com/videogamesaredumb. This week I've got a ton of videos coming up, including N++, the brand new version of N+ that is coming to the PlayStation 4, King's Quest, the Ultimate Collection, whatever the hell that's called. A bunch of other stuff. I don't know. Some JRPG bullshit. Who gives a crap? That's why you gotta come to me, because I will show you some new games. And I'll show them in a way you never expected. With me in the corner.
And hey,
at you.
Repay Colin with likes, subscriptions,
aww,
comments,
and share.
And sexy fan fiction.
No!
Weird, irritating stick, pressure cast, sexy pigeon.
You can reach me on Twitter at Dr. Karate Chop, that's at Dr. Karate Chop, or follow the PressureCast at PressureCastPod. And if you're listening to this, leave a comment below. And if you're listening to this on YouTube, leave a comment below, and we can include that as for the next week's mailbag. Steve, thank you so much for being on the show.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, all right. All right, everybody. Hulkamania will never end. False. It ended. It's over. And it's dead. So you need something to replace that. And I've got the perfect surrogate. The pressure cast. Because the pressure cast is forever. Brother. PressureCast, weekly video game news podcast, is solely owned and operated by Colin Tanner. Guests of the PressureCast are not employees or freelancers of Colin Tanner, the PressureCast, or VideoGamesAreDumb.com, and are not paid. Music featured on the PressureCast is property of their respective owners, and no infringement is intended. For more information, email PressureCast@gmail.com.